February 19th, public safety committee meeting to order. For further business, the school board meeting minutes from January 13th meeting.
Motion. I don't believe we have any public comment. I just want to cover. First of all, the home and baby.
Item 4, family, or let me call it family,
Public Coffee here, Director of Tons of Media Box Emergency Services.
Good afternoon. I'm going to end this afternoon and I'm going to be called and we have an impact. So that's the good news. My work here is done. Now, we've been around this program for quite some time that El Nino could bring greater than normal levels of precipitation to our region. And meanwhile, Donald Trump is the elected president. If more than one city activates their emergency operations center, we automatically activate the operational areas, emergency operations center, which is coordinated with the Air Force dispatch center in San Jose. And so, the goal is to conduit with the state to communicate with the governor's office what's happening related to that regional disaster, and to also look for any and all state and federal assistance that may be available to our region as a result of that disaster as well. So, I know you guys haven't heard already, it's really about a moving of warm water in the equatorial Pacific. And so, we're seeing that it's a historic El Nino, greater temperatures than really have ever been recorded. It's a very strong event. And what that does, the warmer than normal water in the equatorial Pacific draws the jet stream down to Southern California. So Southern California is most likely to receive greater than average rain and a strong El Nino. We have actually warmer than normal waters right here off our coast. We have a range of high pressure over for the good part of February. So we haven't seen those storms falling into San Diego as much as we could in March and possibly April. Not a meteorologist, but I just did a holiday in this past last summer. So I'm here to talk to you about big winds and warm water and what that might be. And the National Weather Service has said over and over that historically with very strong El Ninos, we see most of the rain, the bulk of the rain in the month of March. And their own season is likely to increase to April. Okay, so El Ninos in general are correlated with greater than average precipitation, but as you know, correlation is not equal causation. So there are years where we've had El Ninos and we've had moderate or almost strong El Ninos, and we haven't seen excessive rain and widespread flooding in San Diego County. But there are 2 years when we have had very significant El Ninos during the 97-98 season and the 82-83 season, where we did see that widespread flooding and significant property damage during those 2 years, and this El Nino is even stronger than that. So, disappointing into the drought? Probably not. We are so behind. We have moved almost 23 inches of rain by this fall in order to make up for the deficits that we've seen over the past few years. So it's unlikely that we'll be able to prepare at least the drought after this rain season. But as I said earlier, there are no confidence for significant rainfall risk in extreme Southern California. And we're not to be pinned at a point we might expect that rain just yet. All of that. So, preparing for El Nino, what have we done as a region? We've really been looking at this in an area from a regional perspective for well over a year. We're used to this, the more no notice event in San Diego County, which when we actually had to notice that it was coming. We had the winter weather workshop at the very beginning of the year. We started talking about what we might see. We launched a public awareness campaign to get the members of our community So we want people to know what to do with some of that. We promote that and tell us just where they can go. On our website at readyforyoga.org, there's a video that shows how to ask and install those. The last thing you want to do is put swim bags and flash swim bags and have that water carry right onto the neighbor's property. It's important to know you can't risk whether or not you live in a flood plain. And so that weather map that I told you about, the adverse weather map at readyforyoga.org, has that in your flood plain so you can go on there and see if you live in that flood plain. There are a number of things that people can do, including looking into flood insurance. The FEMA does offer flood insurance. You don't have to live in a flood plain to get flood insurance. You want to definitely clear rain gutters and check your roof during this time of year. You must elevate cable utilities. Make sure that you don't have a closet or heating systems on the ground that may be susceptible to that flooding. Most of the activities of first responders, as we saw during the January 14th series of storms that came through San Diego, were busy with swift water rescue. So we always remind people, it may look like a little bit of water, but don't let people drive through it. So the number one, easy on, and a very expensive car that tried to drive through and help you rescue. Don't forget make a plan to inform. These are general messages for disaster preparedness. We have a family disaster plan that is incredibly simple. It's 5 pages. It doesn't take long to fill out, but these are also applicable to flooding. And we want to have a weather radio, a panic radio. And these are some communication platforms to be aware of. The readyforyoga.org and the pages that I've been talking about throughout the presentation. We also have an SD emergency application, it's a mobile app for both Apple and Android devices. We will update that mobile app and send out notifications. If it becomes a regional disaster, multiple cities have activated their EOCs and their schools because of the damage throughout the county. That's a great waiting for information that you want to go out and speak it in interest and take rights to your mobile site. And then we always encourage people to register their mobile phones with alerts from the other at the region's master notification system. So we have everyone's written one phone number. That's 2 people left in San Diego. You actually have a landline phone, but it's more than that. Many people don't have landlines anymore, so the only way we'll have your mobile phone is if you register it through the alert from the other. And this is a Katrina Highway 101 damage in Del Mar, significant damage from the series of storms that we had January 4th through 8th. So I guess the bottom line story is it's not necessarily over yet, and this is the time for everyone who hasn't done so to
you're working with cities to have the funds completed and then see whether or not there's aid that can be provided. So would it be through our city manager? How is that information being provided to cities?
The information is presented to the Unified Disaster Council, and that has representation from the 18 cities, as well as we have an emergency manager working group. So if your city has an emergency manager, they're aware of this resource. And many of the cities have posted that damage survey on your website, and I really want to encourage, if you haven't done so, to do that. When a storm occurs, it's critical for us to quickly get information about how much damage goes to public infrastructure. That would be the first priority, is to manage out public infrastructure. Second priority is damage to private homes and businesses. So that helps us to quickly communicate with the state about what resources they need to deploy to our communities to get those initial damage estimates. And so that form is a way for us to virtually collect that information. So it can be utilized by city staff. And we really encourage cities to have damage survey teams. We're utilizing county staff from our emergency department, but they don't have to be experts by means. Flooding damage is you're really just asking residents about the value of it and the loss of the loss.
Guys, I think that's a definite opportunity for search teams that are already receiving that type of training. This is the knowledge of my feedback. The emergency coordinator officer is Frank Butter from the City of National City. And we're going minimum, again, we have people fill out forms. There's an expectation potentially of a reimbursement or a, hey, there's a huge amount of pay for this damage, so other than free. Provided. So are there any resources that are provided in addition to filling out the form?
So in many cases, an example would be January 2014 fires that came in San Diego. We do have nonprofit community-based organizations that provide some level of aid. But when it comes to the greater federal assistance, those thresholds are pretty high. So for the lowest level of individual assistance, you would have to have 40 homes that have 25% value. I'm sorry, 25 homes for 40% value loss, uninsured value loss, in order to even qualify for lowest threshold aid, which is low interest loans. So it's a low interest rebuilding loan. That's the lowest level of aid that would come from the state side. Other than that, it really is a community-based organization network that comes together to assist the immediate needs from there.
Okay. And then just lastly, with the floodplain map, which is published on the Ready, what is it, Ready San Diego. And there's pretty parts of map, okay, specifically that are, if you click on it and zooming in, that are within that floodplain. So, I know you mentioned that it would be important just to know. Is it more so on the planning portion or just how you put your hand out there? I guess because it looks like several parts of that must be but it's important on a few different levels. It's important for homeowners to know if they live in a floodplain because it will help them determine if it makes financial sense to get their insurance. It would help them to know, okay, in the past few years, this is it's a likely scenario to get significant rainfall at my property and may flood. For them to make decisions about, putting in erosion control measures, installing those, and taking sort of more precautionary measures. And also for the first water community to know if the floodplain over our intersect. Certain roads that, those aren't good potential evacuation routes. So it has a number of agencies. Thank you. Very much. Thank you. Thank you.
Any other questions for that? Thank you so much. Move on to item number 5. Alternative to detention, regional efforts to strengthen legal and agency protection.
One of your quick introductions, for those of you who don't know, Kathleen Remember, she's been a significant contributor to the health and well-being of our community in San Diego, especially Health Day. She's the executive director of Health Day Community and Services, and we've partnered with her on a number of different efforts here in San Diego County. Google Alert rates are at an all-time low, and we close to care here in San Diego County. And Kathy was a champion of working with the County of San Diego to get a grant from the state, which he's going to be sharing with today, to reduce people who wouldn't be removed from the house. I don't want to give our presentation away, but we wanted to give information to people who are lucky enough to partner with them to be evaluating what the state and the fact that you all would be interested in information and the option right now for countywide. Here's the first thing I want to say. I can't take credit for the idea. I'm talking, I have these passed out, and I just want to say, the series is a little bit of we have what's called a comprehensive strategy for human justice. And it's something that we started 15, 20 years ago. Law enforcement has been involved in the courts, the school district, nonprofit providers, public defenders, the county office. all believe that this comprehensive strategy that we make decisions on and do funding on is really the thing that really helps for us at a region to see people in the fall and regions to do more on the west. And it really is wonderful to see our comp strategy in action in this kind of cycle. Because when there's money on the table, it's always good, but even when we have the years of cuts, everybody sat at the table and put their cuts very well and actually I felt people spent money on the table across sectors. So it's a good network with all the cuts. Alternatives to detention was a piece that was missing until about 3 years ago. Judge Paletti, who was the presiding judge in Scalia's Legal Court, came to us and talked about a number of kids that were in the hall that, in her opinion, didn't need to be in the hall as they were waiting for the court decision. But they were in the hall simply put because their families, in most cases, were dying of families and or inappropriate topics that were in the house. So we started that pilot in the South Bay and the Central Community. Looking at what kind of cool bit model, which is this team and then a thoughtful one, to look at kids that we can take as an alternative. The reason for that is that when you look at the research, these kids who are detained in the court are three times as likely to be committed to death in this decision as used to be identical to them in this case, who are not detained. And I think this is even if the court judges had no choice. They're not missing these children back to a home that is humiliated that nothing will be seen to them. Also, you can spend time in custody less likely to be high school, less likely to find employment, and more likely to get the minimum health care. Teens are two times likely to be rearrested, adjudicated, or convicted of new offenses. And incarcerated and leave in the minute home for a waiting for their or implementation. So one of the main things we do in alternatives to detention is provide that alternative. Now we have a 24-hour response. So 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, we respond to law enforcement and the probation department if they go on a call where they have a juvenile who they feel they have no choice, not because of the offense, because of the future of their home, keeping them to keep them at home. We go out and assess both the youngster and the home situation. In some cases, we're able to stabilize the home situation now and make an agreement with law enforcement that it's okay to leave the young person in the home and we will start the next morning or the next day providing intensive home services. One of the things we have to do is we have to guarantee we're going to get them to the home situation. Given that we feel the home is not going to stay for us to invest in to stay, we then put in an appeal that we feel that's responsible. Actually, some of the reviews here is the 61 who has the license for the process of home is going to come. We are doing this now countywide, as opposed to statewide, and we have been able to recruit foster homes throughout the community that we've brought. In our North Tender, we had a little trouble. Friends who got a nice child in their home for a couple of weeks, you can do that. And I just did a plus for people who do this. You know, they know that there's a single to a female that's in a little problem, and they can go right into the home. We have service partners. We're staff for community services, so we, although we got the grant, we do not want to serve the whole county. We do the response, and the reason we do the response is we already have a domestic violence response team that we're working very well in South Bay, so we just took that and expanded it countywide. So we do this better for our response, but the ongoing services, we contact all cities for organizations, and these counties can do the new services and send for the place a little bit. Most poster is one of the lifelines, and most even in health services. And that's why we put them for resources. We actually put them because they are in kind of community discussion doing contractors with the public and department. So they have a broad family intervention services already in the community, so we do want to do them. Our referral sources are a lot of people do here. Obviously, National Security Police Department, the Police Department, and the Aurora Sheriff had a heads up because they have to just
our goals from the Department of Justice for the is to provide alternative detention services to at least 100 people per week in January. This year, and the first year that we do the structural market instead of January, we did 83 in the East Region, in the South and Central, and then we did 40 in the other regions. Those other regions haven't been up and running, so it was a matter of getting law enforcement training and practices to the working citizens to be able to do some market last year. We have 94% of people to do successfully completed the program. And one of the most successful community is probably the training of a court hearing and standing for referee during the day. So that's even though we're having to make any questions. What we're going for is program that we want to have the authority to make a decision just from the start to make a decision to have no arrest and then to be taken to the doctor's decision to have a doctor. So that is the goal of our program that is for us to bring to the community and for the new program that the system is having to take that different systems to do that. We do that for the entire program. And overall, it's to reduce the number of identity kids who are in pre-medication. One of the things that we're in conversation with the current system right now, for those kids who get in front of the center, what they usually do is call each individual, right on standing with the individual, each individual, and they take them to the hall. And in most cases, these individuals can be filed. So now we're looking at having to be most kids in the program. So we can put them to the same program that comes from the community. So the services that are provided, whether the youngster stays home or they go into the program, if the mission was successful, contending case management and family services, even for those kids that we put in the program, we really provide family services because our goal is to get that family stabilized so that we're going to do that child in the not as a peer shelter because it is school bed, it's foster home. If we can walk away, we will not have a peer shelter for our own, but the COVID but it's still got into that similar walk. Case advocacy, working both with the district attorney and the public defender, I've always been to everyone that this we would have never gotten the law enforcement back to the court if it was not for the defendant, the district attorney's office, and Jerry Pastor, the public defender's office. Those two that were so hard because they saw the need for this program, and they're the ones who have included all the things. One thing is, we have not opened my mouth in this program without benefiting that term for protection. So, it was not just given a quick glimpse of what happened. We also do ongoing after school services. Because we utilize the existing providers in our industry, it was after the alternative detention services that we're able to integrate the kids into those prison programs. And it's best to the team to go to these programs and specifically for boys and programs. So that's the thing that we can continue to provide these services. We also have reporting centers. Because the kids are in a foster home or they're home and their parents are part of work, we have a report when we go to what we call a case happening, which is when we stop the performance and we think that we know it's coming. So that we know that they can do more in this process, just to get to the we also do home and school visits while we're working in the campus. As I said, it's a cool day model, temporary shelter has been in foster homes. We have staff there that have been family visitation services, so we work, and sometimes we can use these private welfare services around the community and the family. We provide all the transportation to the kids. So just because they end up in a cool bed, we also make sure that they get to school, that they work, and then we can set them up.
We also immediately started sending customer support services to the expert family as soon as the next day. And stay home a lot of times and very intense. And then before the year, we have done the grant loading services. A lot of our time of issues that are happening on the family and health is that we have started to address the difficulties to be working with them. And maybe progress from unemployment to decide what are the things that we can do that this family be in place, that this family is in its home, this is going on, this is what comes from this family. Some of the support services that we all provide on the program is outside of conflict mediation. We do a lot of times we do well after the interview with the services, crisis intervention, therapy. So we want to see if they can do a lot of things. Some of them really need access to mental health. Drug and alcohol prevention is sometimes in the emergency services. Academic prevention is a lot of kids that can be for opportunities for detention and not be involved in school. So we try to provide or to get them integrated into actual community programs. All those kinds of things. We also provide financial literacy services and informants to the adults and customers. So in year one, pilot project. So in just using the first 3 years where we did the pilot in South and Central, we enrolled 377 youth. 70 of them were moved to COVID this year. As you can see, we did a lot of work in the forms of origins. We suggested for at least 90% of them. Under that pilot, we provided the youth who attended all courses and were not in the same breakfast grade. 85% of those kids did not reoffend in the school 6 months after the exposure. Why did we do that? It's fine for students to be our new thing that we were striving for. If we've learned a lot, we've learned a lot of things that work and don't work. We also learned a lot about the type of kids that we work with school that work with the type of kids that we need to communicate. So we think we're going to make that 90% impact. The year-to-date staff for this new countywide project, 202 youth have been served, 19, and that means 202 youth who would have been in the fall. So it's not like they would have not gone to the hall, they would have gone to the hall and stayed in the hall for their kids. And for some of them, when they're hearing this, they might have had a routine to stay in the hall. 19 again was completed. So once again, there's just a high percentage of them that were able to provide those family and community services. And our successful conclusion was 90% of the kids. So that is where we are. So I just want to say that we just love working with law enforcement. It's been really easy. And we can follow referrals with many computers all the time. We just from all of the following calls, and so they can take a year, come on up to the hall, and do the inspection. Now we finally get into the mobile referrals because it's law enforcement suggests that we do that. People can make it to be there for people. They do law enforcement so they can do that. Now we can call them to do these tests and then use the inspection. So it's a 3 year ago, Department of Labor. It's Department of Justice, it's the first one. We've always been seeing it. And I want to thank Brenda and the others for their comments. And we need to be evaluated at the very end of the I first resource is from NIDA, which is the National Institute on Drug Abuse, and under the National Institute of Health. We have a plethora of resources on our website, but the most interesting is your information on drug abuse, which is the system in your system. It's complicated because it can be reduced. This is the National Health Services Administration, which is the most important department of health and human services agencies. The focus is to reduce the impact of substance abuse and mental illness. There are not enough times to distribute hospitals, and we have a big session on finding health and treatment. We also have a large session on data, and the ones that I will follow up on. Most interesting is taking up the national survey on drug use and health. We also do the drug abuse warning network, which is on the national treatment of drug related emergency room visits. We also have data on substance abuse facilities and local health. The Office of National Drug Control Policy is part of the Executive Office of the President. They are part of the President on Drug Control Policy. And they produce the National Drug Control Program. This is the Advanced Systems to Reduce Drug Use and Manufacturing Interaction. It is also focused on quality and research for the nation's treatment and recovery. The Enforcement Administration's website, there's policy insights and resource and information systems from that. This screenshot shows the different images from that. And under the drug information, there are fast food and prevention and information. The associated community program is not restricted to the drug drugs in place and wherever you need it. And again, the drug receiving office, along with prosecuting the action prevention programs, in exchange for two local programs here in the window, are one called the Drug Use Prevention Program, where representatives from the Homeland Security Investigative Border Patrol in Washington visit the schools and they talk about the consequences of that in the program. And we also address the role of adults and those under supposed to be in the college. We talk about what the consequences of the program is in the school. The second program we have is the Mass Prevention Program. The USAO partnered with the Canadian Information Department and Safe and Legal and Social Rights Program for the least last year, all four of the communities have been impacted by that. For local researchers, we have to work on some of the data where you can call or you can go online and get an email. And you can search topics of that with staff online. We also have a community of team members on the internet board, but they have a hotline number.
Two parts, one for law enforcement and one for the general public.
you can kind of use more inspiration for like political, any kind of issue. Hopefully, we'll be talking about here in the public in the near future. I think
with that, we will stand there. Thank you.